as well as psychosocial approaches to study how technologies are used in practice. Currently, Dr. Peltier leads the MA Module Education and Technology, Key Issues and Debates, and contribute to MA Education and Technology and MA Digital Media, Culture and Communication. As well, she has had one experience of PhD distribution in this area. Please welcome Dr. Peltier.
Children's folklore is a kind of ever-continuing, ever-evolving thing. It's not just something that's traditional in the past. And if you study children, if you work with them, if you socialize with them in schools, you'll see how computer game characters, worlds, themes kind of are incorporated into their play, into their imaginations, into the narratives that they tell each other, into very traditional pastimes such as dressing up and pretending to be kinds of characters. There's a lot of interest in how people teach each other how to play, so particularly through walkthroughs, say, or through online forums. There are whole bodies of literature on how video games model certain kinds of very high-quality pedagogic processes. And there are whole new forms of social activity, like watching other people play, as all e-sports, which is huge in parts of Asia. And also games are kind of being incorporated into very traditional forms of play, including, say, music play, learning how to play an instrument. So they're incredibly new, and yet they are incorporated into very historical, very traditional, very culturally specific forms of life. And the final element is the industry itself. The games industry can't read any of that, but has grown enormously in the last 20 years. It's huge, particularly in Asia. I think the games market is at least half of which is in Asia. So it's a massive industry that sustains lots of jobs, that makes an important economic contribution. So it raises kind of interesting questions about what is this influence, both economically and culturally. So in the context of these developments and changes to games in the last 20 years, these are some of the questions that are kind of asked repeatedly in education about these things. So the first question, I think, speaks again to Lisa's talk this morning about if gaming is a significant social activity, how can people participate in it more meaningfully, more significantly, with greater degrees of agency? The second question is, how can educational practices be improved by the study of games and culture? What can education learn from the extraordinary things that are happening in games culture? And the third question is, how can the different things that I've just been providing an overview to be used to educational ends? So those three questions are, I would say, the three broad questions that tend to preoccupy researchers who do work in game-based learning and gamification. There are different ways of asking them, but they're the kind of three main concerns. So what I'm going to do now is just talk to you a little bit about projects that I've been involved in, which have tried to find meaningful, worthwhile answers to those questions. First one, which is really thinking about how can people participate more meaningfully in game culture, is a project that I did about 10 years ago. If I can just see if this works.
We need to start by turning around and going back to the other end of the corridor to storage room 1, just outside the door. There we go. So at the top of the map, we need...
But what that was showing was a piece of software which enables 12 to 14-year-olds to create their own computer games. The idea being that in the same way that now we all take photographs, we all make videos in order to, as part of our social culture life, we should also be able to make our own computer games and express ideas, imagination, through a significant cultural medium. But whereas film and photography and publishing have been radically democratized through new technology, until fairly recently, game making was very much an area for specialists, only people who could do computer programming. But there is a very strong argument for widening the pool of people who make games. So, and also enabling people to not only play games, which is obviously very meaningful in itself, but also create games, which for me, if any of you make games, you'll know that's a hugely kind of potentially satisfying and interesting activity in designing games. So we worked with a games company and we developed prototypes working with schools over a period of 3 years to integrate game making into the English curriculum. So the software that I was showing is now being sold across the UK into schools, and it's really being used to teach new forms of literacy. So literacy not only in terms of written text, but also in terms of visual text, audiovisual texts, and particular genre of text of the video game. It raises all sorts of challenges for teachers. You can see that if you're making a game, you're essentially having to bring together very different subject areas. So we focus on English as a subject area, but an English teacher doesn't tend to ask, isn't normally expected to have basic programming skills. The structure of the lessons don't necessarily lend themselves to using, for instance, computers. So it's quite a challenge to integrate this into the school day, but it opens up what kinds of texts can be analysed in schools. And to develop the software, we got children to draw screenshots of games that they would like to make, and that told us an awful lot about the pleasures that they found in games, and also how they use games to develop aspects of their identity, particularly their gendered identity. And that then became also something that we could think about and discuss in the English lesson. So rather than just kind of celebrating games and just being fun and motivating and wonderful, we were able to kind of critically examine how they worked as meaningful texts within children's popular culture, and how they taught ways of being, but including ways of being gendered, ways of being woman or a man, through the kinds of stories they told, through the kinds of representations that they tended to consist of. This extended into another project which is ongoing now at IAE UCL, which is where I work. And I brought this in because Chavin and I yesterday, on Saturday, went around lots of temples in Bangkok, which was fantastic, a great tourist day. And one of the things that's striking if you go around temples and tourists is the repetition of a certain story in the art forms. And you told me it was a kind of the representation of the Yeang Lam. And there is a kind of a similar text in English culture, and probably in all cultures. So in English, it's called Beowulf. It's a key text of English literature. It's one of the first texts you tend to study if you study English literature at university. It's a very difficult text because it's in Old English, it's in Anglo-Saxon essentially. But the structure of it, like many texts of its periods, is very similar in some ways to video games. There are ongoing battles, there are heroes, there are major events that lead to subsequent kind of confrontations. So one of the ways in which the teacher training course
acts is a way into a story.
Teaches,
something you really
how
good
is interacting in
different way.
Think about how they can use games to teach very old texts and getting students on board. Oh, this is so these are training teachers at UCL. They're teacher training course. And they're being shown the different ways in which you can participate in reading literature in schools, particularly through drama, through storytelling. And I just wanted to show you. Find it.
Translations, you can really kind of get it.
Dressing up. My name.
more aggressive side of the hero. And the students began to question, is that okay? Should heroes behave like that? So then it came conflicted about what a hero should be, what it is.
Right, so I don't know if you can hear that very well, but there was an English teacher talking about how in making a computer game about being a wolf, she could start to think about what are the qualities that make a hero, and potentially what's the contradictions, what are the tensions between those qualities? Are heroes allowed to be violent? So that's just one example of how you can enhance people's ability to understand games, to make sense of them as cultural artifacts by creating them as well. So my second case study, and I'll try and speed up a bit because I realise time is really getting a bit more quickly than I realise, is around the use of simulation in medical education. So this is really thinking about how games can enhance educational practices, or the study of games can enhance educational practices. So I don't know if this happens much in Thailand, I'm sure it does, because it seems to be a global trend, but simulators are increasingly used to teach doctors to practice procedures and techniques which you don't want them to learn for the first time as they're doing them on the patient. So in surgery, for instance, it's quite good to know that your surgeon has done that particular operation before. And there are certain things that happen very rarely, which a doctor might only see three times in their career, but which they have to be prepared for. So simulation has always been part of medical education. If you learn to sew someone up after an operation, you learn initially by practicing on orange peel or chicken meat, and then you move on to doing it on a real person. So in the last few years, there's been quite a strong move towards using full body simulators. So these kind of strange looking creatures, and they're made by a doll company in Sweden, so it's kind of quite interesting, Lego. So the company used to make toys, they now make medical mannequins. And one of the things I did a ethnography of how teaching and learning happens in these kind of places. One of the things that struck me as someone who's interested in games and simulations is how the doctors and nurses dress up the dolls and make them kind of much more personable, much more individual. And when I asked them why they did that, they said, well, if you're trying to talk to someone who's ill, you have to know their age, you have to know their gender, you have to know their ethnicity, and that's not in the plastic kind of generic version that comes out of the box. So there's a lot of practices of dressing up, of weaving stories around these characters in order to be able to interact with them meaningfully, even in a clinical setting. So one of the kind of suggestions that I made to the clinical educators is that they should actually use simulation slightly more carefully than they are at the moment. So at the moment, I don't know if you can see that all that well. What happens is that trainees tend to run through a situation, for instance, someone having a heart attack. They get observed through these mirrors by their teachers, and then the teachers tell them whether they performed well or not. You might kind of, I don't know if that makes sense to you, but one of the things that happens as a consequence is that the trainee doctors are terrified of being observed, of simulation as a pedagogic practice, because they feel they're kind of constantly being watched and assessed. So I drawing on play theory, including on Sutton Smith, I've kind of worked with educators to think about kind of blowing the fists and using simulation more as a space to explore the difficulties that people are having as they define them, and explore the meaning of work rather than just as a test of competence. So in the same way that one way of understanding children's play is that it's a space to explore the meanings of their lives, you can transfer that to medical education and use simulation as a space in which trained doctors can think about how they make sense of their professional experience and some of the difficulties that they're having with that, where professional work no longer makes sense to them. I'll skip that because So my third example, which is how the games industry can be used to support educational ends. This is my example. It comes out of a project I've done with the chemistry department at UCL. So if you study chemistry at UCL, you spend quite a lot of your time in laboratories doing practical experiments. That's the stuff in chemistry. That's what makes chemistry interesting as a subject. And before you go into a laboratory, you'll be expected to read about the experiment, read how to do it, read about all the health and safety guidelines, don't throw acid in anyone's face, that kind of thing. And there's a huge amount of work to do before you even get to the laboratory. And this is what some of this guidance looks like. That's about 10% of the stuff you have to read before you do a laboratory experiment. Perhaps not surprisingly, a lot of students just don't do it. So UCL chemistry department basically came up with a virtual laboratory, which I'll play 3 seconds of here. And the idea is that it serves to prepare students. So it doesn't replace the laboratory, but it helps to prepare them for some of the challenges that they might experience in the laboratory. So you can, for instance, learn through critical incidents, like what to do if suddenly your experiment bursts into flame, which is a quite useful thing to know. You can also imagine that one of the things that the chemistry department is now interested in doing is enabling students to do things in the virtual laboratory, which they can't actually do in the real laboratory, because in fact it is far too dangerous, or the chemicals are far too expensive. So, in summary, those were kind of case studies to illustrate the different ways in which the relationship between games and education can be understood. There are, however, some problems with the concept of games-based learning and gamification. So one very common problem is to think that you can make education fun and addictive by just putting a game in there. And as I think someone was alluding to this morning, that's a great way for kind of rendering games actually tedious and boring. But games have particular ways of making meaning. They have particular ways of representing the world, so that the books do, or the film does. And that offers scope for exploring issues and subject matter in new ways. So I would suggest that focusing on meaning and particular ways of making meaning is much more important than assuming that games are just generically fun and addictive. This links to the second point, which is there are many, many really bad educational games out there which are neither educational nor game-like. And that's because they're just very badly designed in both terms. So that's a good thing to avoid. So thinking much more about what can games do as particular systems of representation. And the third point is that there's quite a lot of literature on how social media and social networking is kind of almost making school redundant as an institution, because people can be on Wikipedia, they can teach and learn each other. But games are just a fantastic learning medium. But that argument, I think, doesn't really hold, because schools have a much more profound function in society, and that role doesn't go away because of games and because of social media. So again, I would say that games aren't a replacement for education. The question about what education that schools are for still remains. So that was my quick overview, and if you'd like to get in touch, then those are my contact details. So thank you very much.
So do you have any questions?